more than happy to welcome Jefferson. Remember, today, tonight at 6, we start in the other room the panel on consistency. Consistency is also something that is related to what Jefferson is going to tell you now. So let's greet again Jefferson with a big welcome. And wake him up. Sorry.
How should we present ourselves?
I think if you want, you can
maybe
just
I'll
see.
Bring the chair around.
Yeah.
To get rid of this barrier here.
Yeah. I will stay there, so you. Okay.
Do you want the chair as well?
So how long have we got? What? A lot? No, but I mean, really, how long have we got? Like, just so I can...
I think for the lecture, let's say 1 hour, 45 minutes, one
okay.
hour. And then for the like collective work, another good fat hour, like 1 hour and a half.
Wow, okay, 3 hours, fantastic. Okay, no breaks.
No, we can have a break.
Okay, all right.
Whatever break you want, also coffee.
Okay, wonderful. Great.
So if you want, we can...
So yeah, you know, I was invited to come here, and one of the things that I wanted to do was not just come here and kind of, you know, just kind of present a formulaic point of view or a prepared text or a you know an A to Z of who I am, like a kind of biography or something that would be expected. And what I thought was interesting when Gianluigi invited me was to start was to present or to investigate with you something that is the is right up to the minute of where I'm at in my thinking and my work. And as you said, I've just finished a book project that's taken me 2 years. The title of the book is We Can't Do This Alone, Hack the System. It's a book that's going to be published by Rizzoli. It's not going to be out till April, so I feel incredibly kind of... still very raw. It's at the printers, just at the printers. There's a couple more sections that are going later next week. And in a way, to be able to kind of open it and discuss it, this is the first kind of public or semi-public forum in which I've been able to kind of actually articulate what this book's about and also receive feedback and input from you about how it can be expanded to be more than what it is in its... 300 or 400 pages, because I've been working in a with a small group for 2 years of editors and a great graphic designer in New York, a couple of editors that have been working with me, and a number of different collaborators that I brought in to help me shape the book. And one of the things an element of the book is these. New works that are these slogans that have been interpreted by my graphic designer Ferdinando into posters, and these slogans come from texts that I've used in my work since the very beginning, since the birth of Days to Confused, right through to different projects that I've been involved in. They've been phrases, and it's about language. It's about how a language has been at the core of everything that I've done, whether it's been in, whether it's ended up being in photography, video, film, multimedia, digital, etc. So it's really a kind of route down to the power of language. And I've sent 5 or 6 of them in advance to Gianluigi to share with you all, because I wanted to kind of open source that. Also, at the end of the book, right at the end, I didn't know if I was going to leave it in the book or not, but I wrote a manifesto for myself at the beginning of the book. And at the end of the book, it says something like, why are you still reading this? Then I present a manifesto, which is a set of codes upon which I entered into the book with a kind of a methodology. And I shared that as well. And then the idea is that you're really the first group of people I've spoken to this. No one at Dazed or Confused and in my office, none of the people that work for me know about any of this, right? So what I wanted to do was kind of share it with you and then create a format where we would work together from today onwards to publish a deconstruction of the manifesto. So Gianluigi helped me with this, and we came up with two propositions. One is that my slogans are there, but I'd like to encourage you to share yours with me. And I will collect those and I will publish those alongside mine, not in the book, but digitally, when the book is launched in April. So I'm very excited about that because I feel that you all have a lot to say. And even if you don't know you have a lot to say, you will find your voice through this project, I hope. And for me, the other thing with the manifesto is that line by line, you can. We're going to work with a software called Genius, which is a kind of like a tool that underlines words and phrases and allows you to click on them and then open up a box with an image or a short video or another set of annotated notes that will give additional meaning or reading into the text. And that will be an experiment that we will do here and we will publish back internally within this group as a kind of shared collective work. So the posters are about an individual personal reaction. They're about really your own truth as an individual in how you relate to the system around you, the world around you, the system of communication, the system of creating within either the design world, the art world, the fashion world, consumer culture, subculture, pop culture, wherever you are headed or heading. So on one hand, there's this highly individual approach. You will have time and you will be able to create a reaction and create your own posters, not posters, your own slogans, and send them to me, and I will add those to, and credit you obviously, and add those to my work. The manifesto is an internal project that will be a collective response. Not that you'll all be working together, you'll all make your own annotations, but you will all see in real time the other annotations that other people are making, and therefore you can also react to my work, the work of your peers, and it will shape in real time, over time, a exploded new manifesto or a reworking of it.
Yeah, basically, there are two exciting exercises and two exciting paths that we will start together today. One is the Instagram thing, basically. So yeah. It's like a visual reworking and personal interpretation on our adding new posters, new slogans. And the other is a more...
We'll probably do it as like hashtag hack the system or something
yeah,
like that.
Something yeah. like this. And this is very interesting, let me tell you, because Jefferson is kind of not present in social media personally.
Well, I have an Instagram account. You can follow me.
Ah, or now.
Yeah.
But it's a new thing.
Well, yeah, I mean, new. I mean, But let's put it this way. I mean, I've been present in social media since the invention of social media. You know, Dazed was the first magazine to actually have an Instagram account, for instance. But before that, we were on, you know, MySpace. We were on, like, various other iterations, Twitter, etc. So at the incumbent of every new, social platform, we've experimented with that. And I have personally been involved in the inception of those and in the process of formatting how we tell stories and how we share information within those channels and on those platforms. But what I've done is I've stepped away from making those personal. I've separated my personal life, or I would say my private life, because it is personal. I mean, you know, my investigation of culture is deeply personal, but I mean my private life from my passion for cultural investigation. So that's why it gets confusing for people, because, you know, so much of these tools are used for you know, private diary-esque kind of storytelling, where, you know, you will follow someone where they're at, and people will post pictures of themselves at places or their friends and families and so forth. And, you know, my life has been complicated because I've been in the public eye, and I've wanted to kind of create boundaries around that for certain personal reasons and private reasons. But my Instagram is my own. I upload into it. I write it. I script it. I operate it myself, and it's my vision of how I see the world. And what I'm interested in with that is really, like, to put it into a really to encapsulate it into a short phrase. I'm not interested in you looking at my eyes through social media. I'm interested in you looking through my eyes, if that makes sense.
It's really interesting. Obviously, the thing.
But
that
you can't help getting tagged. I mean, you can't help getting tagged. If you're somewhere and someone takes a picture of you and they tag you, you're there. But I mean, this is out of your control. You know that.
What you've been. The paper you're, like, being distributed now is the manifesto. The other exercise is basically dividing the manifesto in. Can we have one also for us? Like, dividing the manifesto in each single line and then transform every single line, adding references, ideas, images, whatever you want, like ideas, like annotation.
So I'm gonna start with the manifesto, and I'm gonna read it out, because I think if I read it, it might sort of bring a little bit of character to the text. So does everyone have this piece of paper? All right. Yeah. I mean, I don't know. Rizzoli might sue me for giving you this, but then fuck them, because I did write it, but I don't really know about all of those kind of boundaries between the published, you know, publishing those boundaries. I don't respect those boundaries. I like to break those kind of rules. So, like I said, there's 400 pages in this book, and at the end, this is the finale. And it doesn't appear like this. It appears in a certain kind of way that is, you know, this is raw text, right? So it's like a Word document. It's not how it's laid out. Why are you still reading this? The system is a methodology, a way of thinking and doing. The system is something we are all in collusion with. Media, manufacturers, and governments, a reflection of cultural fears, fear of change, fear of extinction. We live in an age of extremes. Never before have so few of the world's population been so wealthy, and so many lived in poverty. So many live in poverty. So many been connected, yet so many live helpless. The system is the pervasive cultural attitude of our time. It is the information architecture that maintains the status quo. It is designed to maximize profit. It is designed to negate change. It is designed to reinforce stereotypes. It is closed to those who think differently or who oppose its value systems. Hackers reroute systems. To hack the system is to pose a threat to its security. Through media intervention in culture, we change perception and offer new routes and possibilities. Hacking is never a shortcut. It's not a cheat. It's not a back door. It's a thirst for inquiry, a responsibility to steer the culture together through continuous, positive, and unparalleled generational change. So that's the text, and the exercise is that you can bring what you like to it, and we will publish it as a, we will present it in a digital format to you. You will have access to it. We will use Genius software that you will all, it's super intuitive to use, and then we'll play this exercise out and see where we end up, and maybe in April when the book's launched, or just before or around that time, we can look at the results of that.
And obviously, if someone of you has ideas now, like you take notes and you can start now. I mean, it's very kind of super fast, but if some of you start taking notes about this, each single line, the idea is that each single line of this manifesto is a sort of chapter, and each chapter is made of your intuition, so it's becoming a sort of collective work. I also invite our staff, our beautiful staff members, and our head of the Fashion Institute, Barbara Trevich, to like not only guide this annotation work, it's like consider it more than annotation, is an explosion. I like the word explosion. It's an exploded text.
Yeah.
No?
And then these slogans. How many of them did you share with the student body? Everything that we have here has been shared? Wow,
no.
Holy shit.
No.
Oh, okay.
Not yet.
Now
we are sharing. Yeah.
Oh, so nobody's seen anything yet?
No.
Oh, we've got them up here.
Yeah,
fucking
yeah.
Great. All right. Cool. So you're in charge here. You can drive the machine. Okay, so so I'm going to just quickly talk through each one, and you can understand the genesis of it. Hack the System is obviously a play on my name. It actually says fuck the system, and we've added some ink, some analog onto the digital, which was really important for me, because this idea of, you know, the speed and direction of communication, which is so consistently digitally driven, is only of... It cannot forget its analog roots, and you know, the importance of the hand, the importance of the analog within the digital is what makes that kind of hackability possible. So for instance, coming together here in a physical space to talk one-on-one, that conversation will lead to, always leads for me to greater invention than when I'm just dealing with somebody over email and via Skype. There's just no doubt about it. Like, we can use those tools to speed up the process, but, you know, without physical contact, the opportunity to come kind of off the, to work outside of the to-do list and for new experiences that are shared together to shape an idea or shape a direction, and for unexpected things to occur, allow some kind of magic to happen in the physical realm that is very hard to replicate digitally, when those tools are brilliant because you can communicate over vast distances, you can keep up real time, you can, you know, transcend borders, etc., transcend language barriers, etc. However, you know, the hand within the machine is the ability to kind of disrupt the machine and break the system. So hacking the system is also the methodology that goes beyond into the manifesto, because it's about rewiring, it's about re-engineering. It's not about... And the reason I covered fuck the system was, and this is really, like, I'm getting the to the heart of it now, which is that nihilism and solipsism, which is just saying the system's fucked, I'm going to go and work over here in this corner and fuck all of you lot, is really an opt-out. And we've seen how those opt-outs have actually just helped the system get bigger, or systems get bigger. So working from within, or looking at the power structures or systems, and by systems I mean we can look at systems of manufacture, systems of production, systems of distribution, systems of creation. They all have systems, and if we're trying to find new ways of doing and new enter into kind of new landscapes and new possibilities, then we've got to break those that don't work for the that don't put creativity first. If a system's designed to maximize profit, if it's a system's designed just to maximize reach, just to maximize scale, then how does creativity exist within that? You know, what's the paradigm? How much of that initial, how much of the initial creative concept gets lost along that way? And also, how same do things become that are within those systems? How much sameness is there? How much homogenization is there? How much flatness is there? Regurgitated formulas, regurgitated points of view, cut and paste, karaoke culture. These are the kind of results that we see from this kind of when everything's put into hyperspeed systematic processes. So fuck the system's not an option anymore, which is why I crossed it out. And the new option, the new way, or what I see as a modern way, by talking to lots of creators and having involved lots of people in my book and having had lots of collaborations, I see that the modern way is actually to re-engineer and rewire the systems and offer new possibilities to work with them, take the best of those systems and ditch the worst of them, and invent our way out of this shit, as Matt Damon said in Martian, the movie. Okay. I don't know if any of you have seen it. Own your own voice. This was something that I wrote in an essay very, very early on in the 90s, and I was talking about the idea of independent media and the idea of why I started a magazine, which was actually a fanzine then, and there was probably like four people working on it. And what I was trying to do was say, you know, own your own voice, self-publish. So it was a manifesto for self-publishing. It came from the 90s. We put it in the book. A cultural resistance movement was actually a phrase that was given to me by Tilda Swinton. We discussed this idea of how we felt that many creators that she'd collaborated with, whether it was Jim Jarmusch, whether it was, you know, Derek Jarman, thank you very much, John Berger, poets, writers, philosophers, artists, filmmakers, were part of what she called a cultural resistance movement, which was a really beautiful way of also saying that just because there is a mainstream doesn't mean that the other stuff that's going on is part of some kind of like muddy little pool that doesn't matter. Actually, there's many streams going on in culture, and this cultural resistance movement is more beautiful and more powerful and more potent, and is actually a delta made of many streams that will take us to an ocean of new possibilities. So that's what that means to me.
It's biodiversity in a way, no?
Yeah. Also, the idea of resistance is interesting as well. Everything always, everywhere, forever, now. Everything always, everywhere, forever, now. Everything always, everywhere, forever, now. Spiraling into a vortex is I can't remember. It was an essay I wrote. It was a phrase I came up with. I think it was for an editor's letter in another magazine. I was describing how the past and the future and the present were one. And that was that phrase, and it really stuck with me as a kind of way of not being stuck in any sense of time, having a sense of timelessness about the time we're in. If you can't afford it, steal it. I wrote this on the cover of Dazed and Confused issue, something probably around the 20s. When I put it on the cover, we got banned for 3 issues. I remember I had to write about 150 individual letters to different news agents and vendors across the UK to apologize, because they freaked out and said, how dare we write this on the cover of a magazine and actually encourage theft and encourage our audience to commit crime. Of course, for me, I didn't think about that when I wrote it. I wasn't thinking, oh yeah, you know, everyone just go out and rob everything. Yeah, you know, that looks good, I'll have that, take it. It's okay, it's legitimate. What I meant was that I really wanted the magazine to be able to get into the hands of everyone. And I didn't want the information and the creativity within the magazine to have a price tag. And I felt that, yeah, you know, if you can't afford it, then the ones who can afford it should pay for it, right? Legitimately, and the ones that can't should have access to it, you know. So, you know, find a way to steal it. And that's kind of what I meant by it. And it stuck with me ever since. And it's kind of still something that I believe in, the democratization of our content. And I believe that, you know, we do our best to get our ideas into the hands of as many people as possible. And that just because of where you're born or what your economic situation is should not mean that you don't have access to the information and cultural content that you want. Okay. Protest against indifference is a much newer phrase that came about through conversations actually with Hans Richter Brist and Douglas Copeland and other people of that ilk, Gianluigi as well. Protest against indifference, which is kind of done a little bit like a sort of, indifference is written behind. For me, this is core, this is central to everything I believe in. We have evidence now of so much that happens in the world that if we just turn a blind eye and say, you know, let things happen, then we're complicit in that, right? So indifference is not a position anymore that you can take in a society where you have almost full and transparent access to so much evidence of how things are made, how they're distributed, how they're sold, what they mean, and also, you know, when you have your own voice through social media, through the channels that you use, through, you know, everyone is media. Everyone is media. And this protest is really, for me, important to everything I do, because it's about saying indifference is a kind of, it's the death of creativity. So this protest is an ongoing protest. It stemmed from the protest against forgetting, which was Eric Hobsbawm's famous slogan that came about with his amazing book, which came out kind of, you know, as a biography of the 20th century. What was it called again?
The Short Century.
Was it? Was something else? Does anyone know it? Eric Hobsbawm's look? No, The Age of Extremes. The Age of Extremes. Great, great book, by the way. Yeah. And this protest against forgetting was like, you know, how can we keep making the same mistakes over and over again when we have so much evidence about everything that we've done in humanity, and yet we still keep doing the same things over and over again? And similarly, a protest against indifference within cultural storytelling, within media, within journalism, within photography, within all of these things, about saying, don't ignore the facts. When you have the facts and you ignore them, it's kind of like, you know, look at climate change, you know, it's like watching someone slowly being murdered and not ringing the police or trying to help them. Like, just by standing there watching it and not doing anything doesn't mean that you're not complicit in the crime, because you're a witness and you have evidence and you actually have the ability to do something, you have the ability to save something and do something. So, you know, it applies to that. It also applies to lots of other things that you can expand into your awareness and consciousness. And I think that's what that means to me. The best way to make money is not make any. That actually says the best way to make money. And then if you read the small print underneath, like the kind of terms and conditions, it says is not any. And so together it makes a kind of new reading of that idea of ambition and success, which of course, you know, is part of our drive, right? You know, it's part of our drive as creative people. And it's part of the value systems that you set yourself at a very young age that you end up playing out through the rest of your career. And I can, for me, in making this book, what I did is I really looked at and talked to the people who I felt have made a really significant and valuable cultural contribution to art, fashion, design, photography, architecture, publishing, communication, media, social change, etc. That's kind of my bag, right? If I had to put some labels on it, that would kind of be my bag. And what I did is I thought, what do all these people have in common? Because I've interviewed them all, I've talked to them, I've asked them about, like, you know, why they did what they did, because my book's about process, right? So really, like, just to take one step back, what I'm doing through this book is I'm deconstructing my process and the process of others who I've worked with to try and create a toolkit for the imagination for a new generation to say, look, this is kind of how a lot of people who have done some really interesting and created a lot of interesting cultural change, multidisciplinarian, across different disciplines, what have been some of the common links and threads and themes that have come out of their work, and therefore provide this toolkit as a kind of, or toolbox, as a way for people to kind of go in and take and be inspired for today. The best way to make money is not make any is really that these people, that what one thing that connects them all is that nobody did it for the money. Nobody did anything that they did for the money. Later the money comes, if what they do that isn't for the money becomes successful, the money comes into the equation, then they have to deal with how they're going to deal with that. So I'm not saying none of them became rich. I'm just saying none of them did it for the money. And that's really true. You know? Huge difference. The ones that tend to do it for the money tend to get rich but make really banal work. what, someone that did it for the money and didn't make banal work. I think, and I think there was a point maybe in the kind of, 60s where you could argue that, the kind of, maybe later on than that, then you can argue that the idea of, even Damien Hirst, who was like, the most commercial artist of like the 90s, who played with all of that idea. When he was starting out, he wasn't doing it for the money. That's controversial, but it's true. Because when you make a diamond skull, it only represents one thing. Optimism as cultural rebellion is another phrase that I've been using a lot with a group of people in London. And this is optimism for me. It's not about a happy, clappy veneer. It's not about like, oh yeah, everything's great. We have to be optimistic. It's just that the majority view or the mass, the mass consumer culture and mass media is all about reinforcing negative stereotypes, all about creating a culture of fear where you're not good enough and you have to, try harder and aspire to a very almost broken set of values in order to achieve, by society's terms, what society calls success. And optimism is also about a sense of self-confidence. It's about saying that we can make the world a better, more positive, less negative place in which to create and produce work. And it's cultural rebellion because the mass of culture is not optimistic. It's deeply pessimistic. And if you buy into that, then what you get is you get a culture of self where I am going to try and get as much out of it as I can for me before anyone else does. And when everyone's doing that, then everybody's just trying to fuck each other over and rip each other off to get as far ahead as they can in the rat race before the rat race eats them up. But what happens is, that's what we see, optimism is about love. It's about loving what you do more than loving the image of yourself doing what you do. And that also leads to being like open. It's like if you're optimistic, you're open, you're sharing stuff, you're sharing ideas, you're open to collaboration, you're open-minded, you're allowing ideas to come in. The opposite of that is a very protective space. My ideas, I can't share them. I'm the winner. I'm the clever one in the group. I'm going to do better than everyone else. Yeah, that's cool, leave college with a grade A plus. But, through life, that might get you far. But the consequence is you're part of an old system. You're part of an old way of thinking. You're part of an old methodology. And you probably make yourself quite bitter and unhappy by the time you hit an old age. Trust me. Delusions of grandeur. Oh, I have these massively. 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 Sometimes I think I'm a rock star without a band. Look. And I have to constantly remind myself that, I don't know the answer and that I have to ask for help and that I'm open-minded and that I'm collaborating, because as soon as you believe your own hype, you know, that is a real beginning to the end of doing new work, right? So, like, to continue to push and evolve your own creativity, delusions of grandeur happen, but you have to kind of recognize them and get rid of them. I have them, and I did a column. So I did a column. It was funny because I used this almost as an ironic title, because there's this newspaper called The Telegraph. I don't know if anybody know The Telegraph. Big broadsheet, and it's quite politically. It's a little bit kind of it's conservative. They call it the Tory graph in England. It's read by a lot of wealthy middle and upper class readership, and they invited me to do a menswear column about men's fashion once every other week. I published a column about men's fashion, and I thought I would use it as a forum to have a bit of fun and try and bring stories into that context, into that paper, that might disrupt what that reader would ordinarily, the diet that that reader would ordinarily have. It lasted a year, and I called it Delusions of Grandeur because I knew that the kind of mindset of that readership was full of delusion and denial and a sense of entitlement and grandeur. And it was my own kind of inside joke. Don't read it, feel it. I also wrote on the cover of Dazed and Confused. And it didn't cause anywhere near as much controversy as if you can't afford it, steal it. Why would it? But what I meant by that was just really literally, you know, it's not about just the content. What we are doing is more than the content. And I think that what I was trying to impart is that, you know, this is information as emotion, you know, so these photographs, these images, these stories, the way we phrase, put stories together, the mix, what we put next to each other in the magazine, how we kind of, the cocktail of storytelling that we produce, this all has an emotional quality to it, and we want you to feel that emotion. And it was the beginning, really, of when the sort of magazine sort of came from being a magazine to being a movement, and people could aspire and understand and become a part of something that was greater than just what was contained in the pages. And We Can't Do This Alone is the title of the book, and it pretty much, you know, sums up my career, if you want, or my path, or my path in all of this, which is that everything I do is a collaboration, and everything I do involves doing it with many other people, and together we're greater than we are alone. And I believe that to create change, to create really interesting cultural change, that we are also in a continuum where we stand on the shoulder of giants, or at least I feel like I do, in terms of those that have come before me, who I've learnt from, who've given their time to me, who maybe are dead, who aren't here anymore, who belong to another chapter in history. But without them, I would not exist and would not be doing what I'm doing. And I'm just carrying a torch. And that torch is being handed over constantly in the work that I'm doing. And what it allows me to do is recognize that I am working not alone. It's not me, but I'm working simultaneously, globally, with many other people that feel the same way that I do, even if I'm not only actually working with them on a, like, without them knowing about it, but I mean, like, as an intellectual or as a sense of an intellectual connection the work of others inspires me, my work inspires them. We're part of something that is bigger than what we do on our own. That's why these kind of meetings and coming here and meeting these other people that are part of the metaphysical club is part of, we can't do this alone, because we all are inspired by each other and also the past and the future. It's a continuum, and I am just a small, tiny part of a much bigger whole. And that is the title of the book, and what I feel makes, you know, it helps kind of solidify that theory. So that's the end. Oh yeah, okay. So there's a few interviews in the book and stuff like that, and there's more. But I don't want to keep going on about something that I can't share with you and can't give you, and isn't out till April. So I hope that has. Oh yeah, and making it up as you go along. I mean, that was the title of the book that I did for Days of Confused 20 Years, and making it up as we go along is really exactly what I do. I mean, I don't pretend that I have any answers for anything at all. I literally just make it up as I go along. And we've always done that, and we've been DIY. You know, we've been DIY is do it yourself. And making it up as you go along is that feeling of also being open to failure, which is so important in part of the creative process. It looks good. It would make a good badge, I think.
Yeah.
Great.
Well, I've been really impressed because we discussed some of these things to prepare this moment. But all together, they make a very... It's a sort of public confession. And it's full of ethical preoccupations, which is something that you don't find often in our world, and especially in the world of fashion, but in general you don't find often. Like with this kind of transparent and very humble attitude.
The thing is, that's what it means to me, but by putting them out here, I'm putting them out without any explanation, right? So I'm telling you this because I'm here doing a lecture for you and you're interested in what's going on in here. Fine, so I'll tell you what's going on in here. But the reality is, the point of this book is that people are going to read into these exactly whatever they want, and it's out of my control. And that's what's really interesting, is how these slogans can be adapted and interpreted by people, and they can make they can become the ones that they identify with, if they identify with any one or two, can become their own. And they can read into them their own thing, like any work of fiction, you know, or fact.
Well, just an idea of an exercise that came to my mind now would be to project here one of the posters you didn't explain and ask someone, or like, to give their interpretation.
Oh yeah, good.
Isn't it good?
Yeah, like, why not?
Our staff or you choose the one. Okay. Is this? No. Here. What remains is the future.
Is future, yeah.
So, is anyone from like our teaching staff or the students who wants to abandon shyness and try to... what does it mean for you? Like, what is your reaction to this? And then you'll tell your... Which is not necessarily the truest. Or might not.
I might not say anything. Because there's no right or wrong.
Absolutely. You might think a little bit. Maybe some of our... I think that Barbara should start.
I knew it was coming.
But then you think someone of you should get up and do it.
Just to give you more time, guys.
Yeah.
Okay, well... That's difficult because it can be very personal somehow. I mean, to me personally, what remains is future, is a selective memory of the best, not necessarily the worst. So it's as a positive value, a according to me, but I think it's a sort of psychoanalysis on a very personal base. It's very personal, so it's not right or wrong. I think that everybody has his own approach. And also, I think it's an age matter. I belong to, let's say, an age now in which memories are becoming more relevant, and that the bricks on which I select how to build my house. I think that in their age, there are less memories and more future. So probably what remains cannot just be referred to the past, but also to the future, to the projection, and not just like that. I don't know if this helped out.
Absolutely. Beautiful.
It's beautiful.
I loved it. It's so great. Thank you very much. but you know, there are more. But we can move on from the slogan thing if we want to.
Yeah, but I don't think it's.
Oh, independent state of mind. That's pretty.
By the way, what remains is the future is also the perfect slogan of a school. This is the school. This is teaching and learning. Every time you pass on an information, an emotion, an idea, you state, like very implicitly or explicitly, that what remains is the future, because you give away. It's generosity, like it's non-obsessed, being ego-obsessed also. It's refusing ego puncture.
Okay. I'm definitely not going to say what my point of view is on it, but
is there someone just
but let's move into a move into a new one if anybody feels that they've got anything to say about an independent state of mind.
No, absolutely, you just
okay, let's do this. This is much more fun. Okay, right, who thinks so? I've got an independent state of mind. I've crossed out an independent state of mind is alive, an independent state of is crossed out, but effectively it's a way of bringing to life this concept of an independent state of mind. Who feels that in the group that this slogan means something or is relevant to how you feel about your work, not necessarily your state of mind right now, but your approach to your work? Anybody feel that this slogan is something that relates to their methodology, an independent state of mind?
Just raise your hand.
One. Two. Okay, cool. Fair enough. Three. Okay, fair enough. So not that many. And I think that's, you know, that's life.
No, but it's also wonderful because it means that it's kind of confrontation. So,
because what's interesting in the book is as well is that there's contradiction, and contradiction is an important part of understanding that, you know, we're complex beings and there is not one way of doing anything. There are a million ways as there are a million people. There are a billion ways as there are a billion people. There is no right or wrong. And that's interesting, you know, and an independent state of mind is a mind that is not dependent on the system. So it goes back to me to hacking the system. And it's about an independent spirit that connects all the people that I've been talking to in the book, because they are not ruled by the power structures that determine whether they are successful or not, but they're successful to themselves on their own terms. So this was issue 5 of Dazed and Confused, and we had a silver foil block. So silver foil block is basically like tin foil. It's like super highly reflective. The cover was that. You saw a reflection of yourself in it, and we wrote Death of the Cover Star on it. Been there, seen it, done it, was the name of a nightclub that I run with some of my friends who were helping me make the magazine at that time. in London, and it lasted about 2 years. And it was an ironic idea for a nightclub title, which is usually titled something really exciting that makes you want to go there. And this was the antithesis of that, which is like, I've been there, I've seen it, I've done it. Why would I bother going there again? You know, this is kind of a very English phrase. I've been there, I've seen it, I've done it, I moved on. It was also a sort of a phrase of dismissal. But I was subverting that and using it in this context as a nightclub because I was trying to say, actually, you know, that position negates the fact there might actually be some worth looking at to it. And actually, yeah, you know, what it was a sort of deference of cool, if you like, sort of, you know. But what we've done is we've kind of erased it and played with it so that, again, we can bring new interpretations and new meaning to it. But it's one of those that could mean lots of things to different people.
Well,
but I like this idea that I've set myself up within this book as well to mock myself. And I think one of the things that you see in some of the other texts is a sense of my own failures and my own mistakes coming out in the book. I've republished texts of mine that I'm particularly embarrassed about. And the editors sort of encouraged me to do that and place them along other texts that I'm proud of because that's who I am and I can't, you know, edit the past to my own vision of what I think my perfect biography should be like. So I've allowed those mistakes to be in there and they make the book more accessible, more fun and more human and more real, but also more scary for me because there's things about it that kind of make me feel like I'm a contradiction and I am a failure and I have said some pretty stupid things. But, you know, you've got to put it out there. And I think that's part of it. And things like that are maybe an element of that as well, you know.
This is really, like, very touching in a way because it might sound a little bit obvious, but there's really a lot of Jefferson in this book, which is, it's obviously, yeah, but it's really personal. It's a sort of memoir in a way, but it's still,
it's forward looking, you know, it's trying to take, what I've done is, you know, I'm sharing with you this really slowly, I guess, because it's a lot to take in and it's new and it's something weird that doesn't come out till April and it's sort of a bit hard to understand something that's intangible like that. But what I've done is I've used archive and new. So what I've done is I've gone through the last 25 years of my work and we've selected different archive, different projects, and I've interviewed certain people like Douglas Copeland, Hans-Ulrich de Brist, Bjork, Tilda Swinton, and other collaborators, and created new works and new texts to sit alongside the past. And then created something that, like I said, is a toolkit for the imagination because it's an investigation of process. It's an investigation of their process and my own process, a kind of deconstruction of creativity. But with a very set of parameters, a very tight set of parameters, which is the world that I exist in, which is sort of like synergy of fashion, art, design, music, and some kind of social activism in there as well.
Which has always been part of the DNA, right?
Yeah.
And it's even more relevant now.
Yeah. Well, I wouldn't say even more, it's just as relevant.
As well, it's always been.
Yeah.
Not just because the times seem be like they are tougher now than in the 90s, or not, in a way. I'd like to, maybe we should have...
What time is that bring us to, by the way?
Four, almost four.
So how long have we been talking for?
One.
Okay, no, but we're talking 1 hour. That was 1 hour.
One and a half.
Was it 1.5 hours or 1 hour? Okay.
So what we could do is maybe have a break and then you prepare something, like, right?
Does that feel good? By the way, you know, what I want to know is, like, has that been, this, has this hour and a half, I'm not, you know, I didn't come with a lecture prepared. I came with this idea of exchange prepared, and I came with this idea of kind of putting out in front of you stuff that's unfinished to help you understand how I would work with you, maybe if you were working with me in a real situation. So it's a sort of a simulation, if you like, of how I might be working with one of my team or two of my team, laying stuff out, me telling them what my theory is of them, them giving me feedback, and us kind of like helping make sense of, is this right to be published, in a way. And I hope that that kind of anti-lecture has been stimulating and inspiring to you. And I also think that the idea of bringing these exercises to you, which is something that I wasn't asked to do, is also something that is stimulating and exciting, because it's participatory. And it's participatory in a way where we can all share and share the results and feel the collective and individual sense of achievements within that. Does that make sense? Okay. Anyone feel like they've been let down and that they haven't had a good time and that they wish they hadn't come?
Okay. Don't be shy. Again.
Okay.
What do you propose, Barbara? Maybe we do a... Yeah. The idea is that maybe if we constitute some groups, then you chop, hop from one group to the other. Yeah. There's also a little bit of personal interaction.
It's not an end, so it's a farewell, not a goodbye. It's been a really humbling day for me, because you're all incredibly smart. It's interesting, the group dynamic thing, because actually you all work really well as groups, and the speed at which you guys kind of reacted to my manifesto was quite overwhelming, because, I didn't expect it to be so strong and so fast and so relevant and intellectual and I didn't expect to learn so much, you know, being in the role of kind of teacher, which is actually, I think I've come away and you've informed my process a lot. So they're typing it up here, inputting all of your new thoughts into that manifesto, and I'm going to take it away with me on a key card, and then I'm going to figure out what the hell I'm going to do with it, and then I'm going to tell your Gianluigi to tell you all what's going to happen with it, or your teachers. I think this is an internal process, and I think it's interesting for me to take it away and edit it, or somehow put it into a format that can be shared and distributed internally with you all, as a kind of conclusion to that part of the exercise. And then the posters I leave in your hands. What I will do is I will ask your lecturers to send them to you. So you have via email a set of them, what we showed here, and then you can, with some instructions about what would happen to your contribution to that, and we will create a hashtag, or we will create some kind of format for your reaction to that to live in the real world alongside mine, so that we can have an exercise that lives outside of the framework of this academy and lives in the real world, and you can all be credited for it, and you can all see how the kind of comments and reactions that those things have and where they end up in time and over time, and that would be really fun. Thank you all for making the time. It's been really fun. I've learned a lot. I'm sure I'll be back at some point, and I hope you've enjoyed it. And farewell and not goodbye.